put off by how long this video is, don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. If the video is too long for you, I have recorded a shorter version and the link will be in the description box. Mafia 2 video game review. You arrive as an immigrant to a major American city and you find that your family has gotten into debt, that you have to work hard and possibly do some unsavory things to pay off. Man, that is similar to Grand Theft Auto 4, which came out 2 years before this one. Anyway, in this, you come back from the military wounded. You fought in Sicily in 43. And your father owed $2,000 and, you know, died basically drinking himself to death, breaking his back, working at the docks. And you are kind of determined not to grow up to be your father, so you instead go for working for the mob. The first half or so of this, the plot isn't too bad, but it really does get to be just tedious and cliched in the second half. This has you rising through the ranks of the mob, and in this you are not a cab driver who, you know, happened to get mixed up with the mafia, and, you know, it was pretty much your ambition to. And, you know, you play as smart and cocky Vito Scaletta. And so, yeah, genuinely an Italian-American. And you and childhood friend Joe Barbaro, who others have already noted is the one really likable character in this, have been doing petty crime for 10 years at the start of this game. And then you get caught and, yeah, military service. The first one was set during Prohibition, and this is, you know, 40s and 50s. And it will tell you at the start of any mission or chapter what year, excuse me, it is, which is frankly absolutely vital because nobody ages in this. The plot has nothing on, like, TV series and actual movies about the mafia. And Vito will narrate in first person. We never really find out to who. You know, in the first one, it was to a cop, because at the end of the day, you know, you felt bad. You were just a taxi driver. You were trying to make an honest living, and then you get mixed up in this, and you have to do all these awful things. You know, you go out of your way in the first one to avoid having to kill anyone. You know, he'll, like, say, you know, you have to disappear. You have to leave town, never come back, and I'll say that I killed you. And, you know, at the end of the day, still, just, you felt so bad, you go to the cops, you know, that's not a spoiler. That's literally one of the first things you see is your character talking to a cop. And it's on record kind of stuff, you know. It's not just like, hey, if you go to this back alley and, you know, say this name to the guy guarding the door, you'll get, no, this is what I did. This is when I did it, you know. Prosecute is gonna, yeah. In this, yeah, we never really find out who it is to, and certainly he's admitting things that, he says nobody else found out about, at the least one thing. And yeah, frankly, I don't think this character would really go to the police and say, this is, I'm gonna help you take these guys down. He doesn't. Yeah, I'll get into that. As others have noted, this fixes a lot of the problems with the first one, but it also eliminates almost all of the best aspects of the first one. Some would go so far as to say everything that was good about the first one. I wouldn't go quite that far, but it's not far off. For sure, this can be more fun and considerably less frustrating than the first one, but overall, it's just nowhere near as good. When you compare it to its competition, it fails completely. And you don't even have to bring Grand Theft Auto into that conversation. It's just, this is not an impressive game. The whole thing is set in Empire Bay, which is basically a mix of New York, LA, Chicago, Boston, and Detroit. You may betray someone, maybe you'll be betrayed, maybe this will happen more than once. In this, unlike the first one, missions don't really go wrong, which I'm really glad for because that got so annoying in the first one. You break your back. And finally get through. Well, not all the missions were incredibly difficult, but you work hard, and then you find, oh well, just that wasn't good enough, and it just, yeah, I go into detail in my video on the first one why that's a bad thing. Yeah, instead, yeah, things tend to go well, although there are some times where something happened that maybe wasn't supposed to, and maybe you'll have to do something to fix it during the same mission or a little later, but it's nowhere near the level it was in the first one. And there are some surprises. At one point you're actually thrown into jail in this. At first, it really does seem like Vito cares deeply about his family. He does what he can to protect them. The initial, impetus for joining the mob is to repay this debt. He tries honest dock work, and it's like, this is ridiculously, I can do this forever, and it would just it's gonna break my body, and my body's going to do things it wasn't built to do, and I'm actually not gonna make anywhere near the kind of money I need, no matter how long I work like this. So okay, I'm gonna go join the mob, which is not exactly, okay, when you twist my arm, it's gonna, but it is the thing that, that is why he makes that choice. He promises his mother, I'm gonna try to do honest dock work, but yeah. So yeah, he goes to try to pay back their debt and try to protect them, but then the first time he's told to kill someone and told that this is gonna be a regular occurrence, he's told to kill someone without really, like, this is not necessarily going to be someone that you like hate or that you're thinking this person deserves to die. No, this is just, we're going to tell you, we're going to point to someone and you're going to shoot them, and that's how it's going to be. And at first he's like, oh yeah, I did that during the war. Yeah, but that was the crowds. This is actual, and he's just like, yep, I'm going to do it. And there's just, yeah, at that point you realize he's a sociopath, and as others note, rather bland. Basically his goal at that point point becomes very clearly just to get rich and, you know, stop having to do much of anything. He just wants to have fun. And he's shown then to care far more about material possessions, those in his possession, than his family. And I fully realized that people like this do exist, did exist at the time. That doesn't mean I want to play as one. I don't want to spend enough time in the head of someone like this to complete the game. And as others have noted, you don't really feel like, you know, you're really doing mob stuff until, you know, close to the end, where honestly, in the first one, it happened much sooner, almost immediately. And there's also just, there are so many missions in this where you don't really do very much. It feels like it's just, you know, maybe they had some story to tell, or maybe they needed the game to be at least a little bit longer, but the mission is pointless. And certainly there's nothing you do during it that's like, yeah, I'm really good. You know, basically, a video game should, any mission or level or the like should have your attention, should have you like recounting it to friends, should have you, you know, impressed with what it asks you to do. And, you know, I recently replayed Splinter Cell Blacklist, and, you know, as I mentioned in the review of that, you do so many such cool things. You know, we're at that point, it's, I believe, game 6 of the Splinter Cell series, you'd figure there's nothing left. But, you know, you're breaking into Gitmo. You are like attacking someone in their own mansion, and you know that they have a panic room, so you set off, like, you know, you mess around with his, you know, like security kind of stuff to trick him to go into his panic room, so that you go to the panic room and then break into his panic room so that you have him. You know, he even says no need to chase him down if I back him into a corner. You know, you're stopping terrorist attacks left and right. Just, there's no mission in Splinter Cell Blacklist that isn't memorable. There isn't a setup. Even side missions, all of it is memorable. All of it is stuff that you can, yeah, you know, and yeah, that really should be one of the goals for any video game developer. And some missions you just have to walk between the, you know, maybe from point A to point B, maybe back and forth between points, and just press the use key. There's literally one where you're like, you know, selling illegal cigarettes, and literally some of this mission is just you standing on the back of this truck, you know, where all the merchandise is, and they say, okay, give me a pack of blue ones, and you're like turning towards the blue pack, to the car, you know, the box of blue packs, press use, and then the next one will ask for a red pack or a white pack, and that's it. You're just thankfully, at least it does, you know, do the montage-y fade kind of thing, so you're not staying there forever. But it's just, this is actually something that you spend time doing. There's no reason why this should be so boring and such nothing. And it happens over and over in this. Drugs do seem like the one thing that they refuse to touch, you know. And, you know, you're collecting protection money, you're, you know, involved in smuggling, you murder people. And it's all about, the family, whether biological or otherwise. In this, less about biological, and very with or against, and it's the business, or maybe there are some friends that get in the way, and where in the first, when you killed people, it was in self-defense. They were typically criminals, or they were dirty cops. You could kill regular cops, but it wasn't like really a goal, kind of. They're, it was more that you'd maybe be chased by them and have to get away from them. But in this, even early on, you kill cops by the dozens, and there is no hint of remorse from Vito. I get that, it's the reservoir dogs thing. Did you kill anybody? Just cops. Okay, so no real people. It's the thing of they demonize the cops, they dehumanize the cops because the cops are just trying to stop them from doing what, their livelihood. So, but there's no hint. Even early on, there's no like, I sure kind of wish that I didn't have to kill that many cops. At least all of the, in the span of minutes, but nope, nothing. This came out 8 years after the first one, and the third one is, maybe due for this year, and that means another 6 years between two and three, and yet it's still rushed. This one, I wouldn't know about three yet. This has a very, cinematic kind of style to it, with really expertly done cuts and angles in cutscenes and some very Scorsese montages. Some of these videos you can skip, which is good because some of them are really long. One mission starts with, and I'm not exaggerating, 5 minutes of nonstop cutscene. Then you finally get to interact, and it's just walking for a couple more minutes. Finally, the mission starts. And this is, again, even like not all of it is in real time. There's again some montagey fades, which, it denotes that more time has passed within the montage, but yeah, it's still just. And this didn't need to be so. Yeah, I would almost guess that there were like things, like mini game kind of features cut or something, because it's ridiculous to start with such long cut scenes that aren't that like. Like I said, they're cinematic, but they're not like just amazing kind of, again, briefly, Splinter Cell Blacklist, it doesn't tend to be more than a few minutes of cutscene between, when you interact, between sections where you actually get to play the game. And every single cutscene is so fast-paced. I've watched them so many times because, I mean, even just when you're replaying, there are three different play styles. So three entire playthroughs of the entire game. There's like one level where there's one of the play styles that you can't do, but that's it. And so yeah, I've watched them, tons of times. I've completed it on all three play styles at least twice now. So, six times, maybe a little more, if every cutscene basically. And yeah, they it's like NCIS but good, very very fast paced. And in this, it's just it's the kind of building atmosphere kind of thing of, a lot of these cutscenes. And yeah, it's just and it didn't have to be that so boring and so long-winded. And again, note that you cannot skip all of these cutscenes. One, or maybe there were two, but hardly any first-person perspective cutscenes, which it's the only, nothing else in this entire game is first-person perspective. Not even like, nothing. It's always third-person perspective. Outside of like some of the, you can when you're driving the car, but it's never like, it doesn't feel first person perspective-y. It's a third person perspective game, which, really makes the one or two times that it forces you into a first person perspective feel really awkward and out of place. The ending is lame. I read that it was going to be lame long before I read this before I started playing, and I was like, okay, I'm gonna try to notice if the ending is lame. Having just completed it, is many, many shades of lame. There are so many different ways in which it is lame. It's a cop-out, it lacks satisfying resolution. There's kind of sort of a few twists to it, but none of them go anywhere interesting. It's just, I almost feel like they look, I already said it was rushed. It almost feels like they ran out of time, or that wasn't supposed to be the actual ending. It's just, and do note that you can't actually go, you can't walk around the city once you've completed the game. You'd have to go back to an earlier, but yeah. And really, it so easily could let you, because the plot has largely been resolved. It just seems, yeah. Anyway, the voice acting tends to be really good. However, the characters are really not particularly memorable or like, all that distinct. They're all very cardboard cutout-y, and I mean, I was gonna say that you'll forget it not long after having played the game, but you forget it even in taking breaks from playing the game. So, yeah. It is nice that, characterization-wise, you meet a lot of lower class people, which means that even some of the minorities you meet, they're really tough, like African Americans and like women, they're not really, acting like it's the, they know that their person counts for almost nothing in the eyes of most people, but they've got a place to be. They've got backbreaking labor that they have to be, just get out of the way. That's a quite nice, because it's, they're never going to be, this is when they're relating to you. It's not when they're relating to the cops or the, you don't necessarily see too much of that. Or like the, maybe the African American to his landlord, or the woman to his, to her husband, But when it's just, they're, yeah, because that, it was a very hardening kind of, creating calluses, because working people really had it awful back then. Now, this is quite bloody, and it's, there's a lot of, strong language, and I don't mind. I think, it could fit. It didn't have to fly in the face of the realism that the rest of the game goes for and largely accomplishes, but it does, because it's, F-bombs and all these modern, and, you might say, well, okay, if they use the swears from back then, it's just gonna be distract. You know, they've modernized the language, but it's the only part of the language that they have modernized. Everything else, they are talking the way they did back then. You know, dialect, accent, the words and descriptions and everything. So yeah, this is much less romantic of a vision, which doesn't mean that it doesn't still have some of the kind of mob life, with a lot more ugly details than the first one. And there is some like tragedy, and you know, but it's much less about that, you might say, than the first. And as a period piece, you know, it is limited by that. You know, the vehicles, which basically means cars, the weapons, the one city. You know, when I first heard of Mafia back in 02, it was like, yeah, but how does it at all compete with Grand Theft Auto, though? And to be fair, the first one really, it almost did come out before Grand Theft Auto 3, so it would at least have been 3D before the Grand Theft Auto series was. But yeah, it's just, I'm not saying that every game that has like cars and you going around a city has to compete with Grand Theft Auto, but I do think that when you know, any game has to offer something, has to sell itself by saying, this is what I have. Not every game has this, you know, preferably no other game quite has this. And all of these two really have is the authenticity and that kind of thing. And I think they should have done more to make themselves appear very different from Grand Theft Auto, since they really don't have anywhere near the freedom of Grand Theft Auto. You know, an example would be something like the Just Cause games. The first two, I forget, is the third one out yet? Anyway, they basically say, okay, but what if Grand Theft Auto was on an exotic island, tropical island, and you were an over-the-top action hero protagonist, you know, so you're, you know, using a grappling hook to attach yourself to, you know, you send your car flying into the air, then you jump off it, use your grappling hook to get onto the enemy helicopter, throw him out, then use the enemy helicopter's weapons against the other enemies. Maybe your helicopter gets shot down because there are just a few too many of them. You know, parachute away, shoot from your parachute. Maybe you steal a jet. It's just, you know, there are a lot of things that Grand Theft Auto has that the Just Cause games do not have. But the Just Cause games don't try to be Grand Theft Auto. Or, you know, you might say Grand Theft Auto clone, but they go in such a different direction that, you know, yeah, they have such different things to offer, where this and the first one just kind of feel like Grand Theft Auto without the freedom and locked into a time period where, you know, yeah, you just didn't really have a lot of things that, it just, you know, it, having access to a bunch of cars is never going to compete with also having access to helicopters, planes, you know, boats. It's just, yeah, you just, it's never going to be the, you know, and it doesn't, there are aspects of Alan Wake that are reminiscent of Grand Theft Auto. You know, you can sometimes drive and you can swap cars. You know, there's there's a certain degree of openness to some areas, but it's very distinctly not Grand Theft Auto mostly. And yeah, these two just feel like they're trying to be, or should almost be, Grand Theft Auto. But yeah, the authenticity is quite, endemic. It's everywhere in this, and yeah, almost everything feels just like it. Yeah, just like you're in that time, and you're always, you're in fancy restaurants, luxury cars, and such. This and the first one were re well received, and hence a third one is on the way. There is some, the weather will sometimes change, and I've certainly seen that, it, and in general, it might be nighttime, might be daytime, might be sunny, might be rainy. All in all, the game is basically above average, but nothing more than that. I am reviewing the PC version and not the DLC. Excuse me, and I do realize that today it's, the certainly on Steam, you currently can't get the PC version. I got this back when I could, and didn't play it until now. This has very thick atmosphere. Others have pointed out already that it's basically like Max Payne without the bullet time. And very clearly a labor of love. And you again have this GPS with, showing objectives, cops, enemies, and when, and this even on foot, which, was also in Grand Theft Auto 4, which again came out 2 years before this, but this was also in the first game. Although in that it wasn't on foot, but in this, like the first, only when you're in a car, the it will, yeah, anyway, in this, when you're in a car, but only when you're in a car, it will show the shortest route to your current objective or your own waypoint, or I guess. And in this one, unlike the first, you can look at the whole map at, any time. And yeah, you can place a waypoint of your own anywhere, anytime, and remove it again if you change your mind. And it won't interfere with the objective marker. This is a third-person shooter with a 360-degree free camera. You can vault, although you can't always see where, and sometimes that means you'll try to vault over something that, while you're being fired upon or something, and it won't let you. Somewhat like Assassin's Creed, you can sometimes interact with things in a violent or, more subtle way. If you're breaking into a car, you can break the window or you can pick the lock. You can kick a door open or you can just open it regularly. The controls are fine. You may want to change a few of them. And some of them you really can't change, and just they're never going to be completely comfortable and just, yeah. And for some reason you can't change how you back out of the, if you're trying to pick a lock and you're finding it's just, taking too long, the only way to get back out of that is pressing backspace, which if you're using, you know, the WSAD, WASD, yeah, it's completely, you know, suddenly you have to press this key that you're not otherwise using. Yeah. This has an actual cover mechanic, which the first one sorely lacked. You know, in the first, you just crouch behind things. However, it is still very much that you're just, you know, ducking behind cover. You know, you're either, you know, you're either above or to the side of the cover. You stick your head out, shoot, and then you can go back. And yeah, that's basically it. The enemies will rarely flank, and you know, the mechanic itself is kind of stiff. You can sometimes like press it when you're relatively close to something you can take cover behind, and it'll like, you know, he'll like do a, you know, very quickly make his way to the cover and then go into cover. But, you know, going into cover and going back out of cover feels slow and stiff. And, you know, you really can't do very much with it. It's a very basic cover mechanic. You know, you can turn corners without going out of cover, and you can use it to hide for, you know, for the stealth. You know, but you can't blind fire. It's not like you can very easily, comfortably move between cover. You know, it's limited how many games I've played with cover systems. But for example, in Deus Ex Human Revolution, you know, if there's a space between two otherwise lined up objects you can take cover behind, you can tell it, you know, okay, now move from this cover to that cover. And yeah, nothing like that in this. And you also can't use it to vault, which, yeah, sometimes comes in really handy for cover. You know, if there aren't many left, then it can maybe be more useful to vault and then start shooting instead of remaining behind cover. The gameplay is just through and through incredibly bland. You heal by eating and drinking, which sometimes means that you can do it, you know, during missions, you know, if you're not in a chase or the like. And yeah, you stop at a restaurant or something, you can go in there and heal. And otherwise, it's, you know, it's right before a mission starts proper, or once the most dangerous stuff is over, that you can go and heal. And you cannot swim. This, like the first, has no multiplayer, which, considering that Grand Theft Auto 4 does, and it's amazing, it's a little bit disappointing, especially considering that with how it's, especially something that would work well in this would be just co-op, because you're almost always like, there are times where Joe isn't around, but so much of the time you spend with him, sometimes even with a couple others, but especially with him, and you're, you know, considering the cover mechanic, maybe, you know, one of the co-op players, you know, co-op player A is like shooting from behind cover, co-op player B tries to flank the enemy, you know, something. But yeah, it's just not there at all. This has checkpoint saving, but is nowhere near as often or as logical as the first one. In the first one, it was basically, when you got to a new area and or when you've completed, like when you get to an area, maybe you have to shoot a bunch of guys there. Sometimes maybe it saves right before, maybe it's not, saves right after, maybe both, after killing all of them. In this, yeah, sometimes you will have to do some of the stuff you already did when, yeah. And like the first, it saves the guns you have, the ammo you have, even some nearby cars. And a lot of people find it really, yeah, a lot of people have problems with it. I guess I get some of, I mean, certainly in this, some of them are really poorly placed. But on the whole, I mean, if it's playing the whole mission over from the start or having checkpoints, then yeah, give me checkpoints. Give me bad, give me terrible checkpoints any day of the week. Keep in mind, you are not forced to use the checkpoints. If you want to start the mission over from the start, you just go into the menu and say start over. You're not forced to, complete. If something about the checkpoint is bothering you, can go back and redo. And again, we wanted it from Grand Theft Auto right from 97. In the 97, you can't even really save. Although, back then that was kind of, it's old school tough game, but yeah, Grand Theft Auto didn't get it before 2010. This series had it back in 2002. And in 2010, it wasn't even the main game. It was the Lost and Damned, the DLC that, sure you could also get it, as a standalone, but yeah. Has some slow load times. Some say there are a lot of bugs and glitches. I really didn't run into many, barely any. Now you don't buy where where you live. So, which, to be fair, you don't in all Grand Theft Auto games, but it's entirely story driven where you're living. And sometimes they will get you a, sometimes they will upgrade where you're living, and at least once they'll even get you some of the clothes that I don't know because I didn't try if I could have bought those clothes myself, and then if like the money would be, if would he have that much more money as if, or yeah. And then at the same time, it'll also sometimes take away where you're living or, clothing that you bought or that it gave you. There aren't that many collectibles in this. And for some reason, it doesn't store the really fun one-off mission clothing. You'll like dress up like cleaning personnel. I want to say like telephone repairman or something that, you. I'm not saying let me wear this on another mission. I'm just saying, let me at least, put the game actually has the you have an actual wardrobe where you live, pretty much no matter where you live. And every morning it has you at the start of pretty much every mission, you have to go to the wardrobe, put on some clothes. For the first bit of this game, I'm not going to give away how far, you barely even have more than the one suit, so you're just getting up, putting on the one suit, and then the rest of the mission can proceed. And it'll continue to be that slow and boring for at least a little while longer. All I'm saying is, let me at least put on the one-off fun mission clothing and just, look at him just like that, and then I'll put on some serious and go, But yeah, it feels, feels like work, and games really shouldn't feel like work. And the first one had a lot of features that were either brand new or weren't really thought of for the genre. This one really doesn't have much new, and especially, I've already said it, it doesn't, there are a bunch of things in this that aren't, that were in, the, like the checkpoint saving. If you just want a checkpoint saving game of more or less this kind, yeah, you can go for aforementioned Grand Theft Auto 4 DLC. And yeah, I mean, there are some, but there's very little that's new or distinct in this. It feels very safe. And yeah, it's just I mean, there are a lot of games that play it safe, but it's just, it's such a step down from the first one. The first one had so many things that were so interesting, and some of them were, yeah, I've gone into detail about that in the video before, but it was there. There were cool things in there that weren't, that really took you by surprise. It's when you start playing a game, it should really grab you. It should have you thinking, this is gonna be fun, and yeah, this one just doesn't do that anywhere near as much as the first. And if you play on for just a little bit longer, you'll soon realize that this one really barely, yeah, this doesn't offer that much at all. There's really very little replayability. Missions play out pretty much the same. There are a few where you can maybe change the outcome some, but ultimately, yeah, it doesn't really, there's not much you can really do. And yeah, and it's I suppose that more or less covers that aspect. The yeah, if you run over a trash can, you'll literally see, like, discarded papers and, like, banana peels and stuff fly in the air. If you run over a mailbox, you'll see letters flying in the air. Run over a fire hydrant and water will spray out. In this, you get to use an MG42, but it's so rare, you just miss it the rest of the time. So I almost wish they didn't have, yeah. But this does have more types of weapons and bigger types of weapons than the first one. And, yeah, it still has nothing on Grand Theft Auto, but at least it's getting in the better, You can now hide any weapon and you can carry all of them. In the first one, you could carry a few. A couple of pistols because you are wearing a jacket. You could hide a few, similar to the first, Hitman game. And, Hitman hiding weapons is all over those games. But yeah, and in the first one, you really, You can hide maybe one larger weapon, but that's it. Because, excuse me, what else are you gonna do? You could, excuse me, you can maybe hide one in like your coat, but you can't, and you certainly can't carry a bunch. And this is especially strange because when this came out, unlike when the first came out, everybody expected the kind of thing where you can carry, a single like primary, a rifle or something, and then you can have a single secondary weapon, a pistol or a small SMG, and that's it. The first one did something similar to that before almost anyone else. Like I said, the Hitman did the same, but and if the first game almost came out at the same time or before Hitman 1. So, and yeah, in this you can just, carry all of them. It's which again, to an extent similar to Grand Theft Auto, but yeah. And you can again use grenades and Molotov cocktails. The stun locking has been dialed down tremendously, thankfully. Basically, you are rarely stun locked, but you can take bullets without being stun locked but you can often stun lock enemies just briefly with your own bullets. And the shotgun is no longer too weak, although they've now gone too far in the other direction and basically made it too strong. Obviously, it's most powerful up close, but it almost works as a rifle in this. And the actual rifle is a little more rare to come by during missions. You may have to buy it. And yeah, you can now actually buy weapons and you get to carry, you get to keep them, you get to keep the ammo. And yeah, that's something that's so frustrating about the first one. And yeah, in the first one, the game decides what weapon you're going to have, and often you will only start with just a single pistol or maybe two. And much like in Grand Theft Auto 4, in this you pretty much pick up what you need, and in this, if you pick up I should maybe say I'm talking about easy difficulty. I didn't try the others. I'll get into why. If you pick up even a single gun that, the first time you just pick up a gun, it'll have a certain amount of ammo. It'll have however much ammo there was, or maybe some of what you were already carrying, whatever. But the second time, when you already have the gun and you pick up another from the ground, it's gonna give you full ammo, unless you haven't reloaded, but it's, yeah. And in this, no matter when you reload, you will never lose any bullets. He doesn't toss away the clip that, so yeah, it doesn't matter that much when you're going to be reloading. In this, you barely even, I mean, if you suddenly find, oh, there's, at least a little too many enemies, I'm almost out of ammo for, this current clip is almost out of ammo, just swap to one of the other ones, and then reload when things have calmed back down. You're very often told bring a gun, and this is so it's so distracting because you don't actually have to go to pick one up most of the time. If when you die, you respawn to the most recent checkpoint, so you don't, respawn outside of a hospital having lost all your weapons and ammo. In that case, it makes sense for you to go and get some weapons before you attempt another mission. In this, it's just, yeah, and it's not like, A lot of times when a character will say something to you, it is like a hint, and sometimes that is the case here as well. But yeah, just this, why not just, they could easily have changed it slightly, reframe it, just have, meet me there and there, and then Vito saying, I already have a piece, or I'll bring a piece, or something like that, or for them to just not say it at all, because the just, yeah. And you can't look up what you are carrying if you're somewhere that weapons aren't allowed, like, where you're living, for example, the apartment. And it's just, obviously, I'm keeping the weapons in the apartment because how else would I be carrying them, And the game makes me put on clothes. Why doesn't it make me, just briefly look at like weapons or something? And so you have to leave the apartment. The moment you're outside, if a cop spots you with a gun, yeah, he's, that's, they're gonna try to, yeah, that attracts attention. One time I was so certain, okay, this is safe. Me and Joe are just outside of, we're in a, the area behind a shop. So this should be perfectly fine. Okay, let's see, what am I carrying? How much ammo? And the moment that I bring out a gun, Joe brings out his and starts shooting at this random guy who's like, I think he's like, it's like coal work or something. He's standing, he's working behind a store, in a back, kind of. There's no indication that we need to shoot him. I didn't point a weapon at him, but Joe just randomly starts, and then it's like, well, okay, do I try to avoid the cops? Do I just, okay, how much progress would I lose if I loaded to last? And this is even, I went to a gun store and I was still not, or actually, could I have brought out a gun? Actually, I think that if you bring out a gun in a gun store, you might be, the game might think that you're trying to rob the place. So, yeah. It's just, there's really no reason. Again, this is something that both the first game and Hitman solves easily. You can look up what weapons you have without drawing them out. It's that simple. And even if you're not that worried about, what am I carrying, how much ammo, if you're reloading, if you get through a fight and then you need to reload, but you didn't do it before, then yeah, you have to do it outside of a fight situation, and it has to be outside of an apartment. You have to be careful that there are any cops around or any other people around, or failing that, that Joe isn't there because, he was the one who drew the gun. The shooting is a lot more fun and less frustrating than the first one. And, a single headshot will kill, and three body shots will also kill. And, the crosshairs will help you in determining whether, if you point it at an enemy, it'll turn red if you can hit them from, if there's something in the way or something, it'll just stay white. And if you point to an ally, it will, support, renewable energy sources or go green. During gunfights, your allies will eagerly and often run right in front of you. I mean, I'm not sure I ever accidentally hit some. I think I almost did, but then it turned out that the game doesn't let you fire if you're aiming at, a friendly, but yeah, nevertheless, that should not happen in games. Melee is back, but it's now without a weapon. You know, where in the first one it was very much about, you know, having the best kind of weapon, you know. Yeah, you were very careful in trying to figure out what weapon to use and watching out for what weapon the enemies would use. There is a lot more detail to the melee fighting now. You can do light punches, hard punches, you know, dodge, taunt. If you're dodging and you time it right, you know, if you're dodging, the enemy attacks, you can do a counter attack. And there's no real, when you're dodging, you know, for the counter attack, you have to time it right. There's a narrow gap that you have to, but you can just hold down the dodge key and you'll keep dodging, and eventually either he'll stop attacking so you can attack, or you do a counterattack, and that's it. You know, there are some brutal finishers, which thankfully you're prompted for, because otherwise you wouldn't really be able to tell when it's time for one. And you can grab and then do finisher moves. The game badly needs a block break. There's nothing that, you know, you can dodge for however long you want. Your enemy can dodge. There are going to be parts of fights where all you and he are doing is dodging, waiting for the other person to hit. And eventually he'll get tired of dodging and he'll, you know, try to hit you, and then you're either countering or you're waiting for him to stop hitting and not dodge so you can hit him. And that's it. When you're in prison, there's a prison fight club that is entirely, you know, if it's your first night, you have to fight. Thankfully, it's mercifully short. Basically, every fight plays out the same. And thankfully, there's very little of the melee. You know, you're not forced into melee very often. You can do it other times. But because it's so samey, it does get to be too much. And, you know, the first one also had much more exciting melee combat. There are more, you know, there are some vehicles in this that weren't at all in the first, you know. In this one, I believe it's 30 or 40 vehicles. Meanwhile, in the first one, it's, I believe, 60 or 70 with an additional 30 bonus ones, you know. So, yeah. One thing I will say is, in this, I'm not sure there are any cars that are just terrible, which in the first one, there are a ton of. And it's just, look, we recreated an actual car from the period. Isn't that cool? Very good job. I can tell you put a lot of effort into it. Now, could you please get it out of the way so I can get to one of the good ones? And that really isn't the case here. There are four separate camera angles when you're driving: a first-person perspective from the front bumper, from the left front wheel, and then a third-person perspective, you know, with full 360-degree free camera, which, you know, the same, basically, as for when you're on foot. There's a key for looking behind you when you're in a car, and, you know, you now have a garage where you can really choose, you know, yeah, if it has a good garage system. And in the garage, you can look up the stats of the different cars, but again, it matters a lot less than the first one, because there aren't that many. You know, some of the cars are definitely better than others, but there aren't any really terrible cars. Where in the first, it's difficult to tell from looking at a car which is especially good and which isn't. And though, you know, when you're starting a mission and you're just in the garage, you can see. But during a mission, if you have to steal another car, then you just have to try to have memorized what they look like, the good ones. And then the garage has a limit, and when you're asked to eliminate something from the garage, they expect you to know by name which one you want to get rid of, which is just ridiculous. And this is a lot like the Grand Theft Auto style garage. You choose which cars go in and which cars go back out. You can't explain that. And in this, it's, ignore the fact that the garage looks distinctly like it would fit one, maybe two cars. It'll fit 10. And any garage you have in the whole game is shared with the rest, which I appreciate it, but it really goes against, it really strains credulity when the rest of the game is so distinctly realistic. I mean, for the weapons, at least it's just, you know, whatever you have, whatever you buy, whatever you pick up is still at your house. You know, you can pretend that he puts it in the, you know, when he puts on clothes for being outside, he, without us seeing it, also puts whatever guns he had, you know, in there so that he wasn't like sleeping surrounded by guns that are, in that case, more or less invisible. But yeah, with the cars, yeah. And the. You know, they're not every mission lets you store your, you know, the car you're in by the end of the mission. Some of them end as you're approaching the apartment or without you even going back to the apartment. And the cars, you know, in the garage, up to 10, are the one thing the game never takes away from you. And some have noted that the cars handle far too similarly. And you know, basically like, you know, a shed on wheels, and yeah, that you know, the handling could be far better. And thankfully, rain, at least I found rain to be very rare because it was ridiculously difficult to drive in the rain. You know, the cars slipping and sliding all over the place. And for sure, some of them are, you know, are not that great. Of, you know, but, and you can, you know, turn steering and braking assisting off, which makes the handling much more like real life. And, you know, the speed limiter is still in effect. You know, you toggle it on or off, and it'll literally put a, excuse me, a roof on the how much the car will, you know, how fast the car will be allowed to drive, and you simply cannot accelerate beyond the speed limiter when it's on, which means, you know, you don't have to worry about police attention from that, at least, which can really come in handy. And then at other times when you're chasing, you'll want to turn it off. And it's super easy. You can, you know, there's, it's really easy to tell whether or not, and it's just pressing a key to toggle. Shooting from a car is far more rare for you, a few times at least. It's mostly the enemies who do it. A few times at least in this. Someone in your car will shoot at the enemy. I'm almost certain that I never got to. Why did I never get to? And it's of course also the kind of thing where you can't tell the guy, you know, anyone else in the car to shoot or to not shoot. So sometimes, if you happen to get some police attention, they will shoot at the cops, which obviously gets you into far more trouble. And other times, they will refuse to shoot, when you really need just a little bit of firepower to get rid of, yeah. The you can repair in any garage, in your garage, since they're shared, and you will also be told if the car is wanted. And you can't fix it being wanted in the garage, but it does, you do have an option for that as well. You can also, and it'll also tell you whether or not you need to repair and how damaged it is. So if you're like, I don't really want to risk not having enough money, then, yeah, if the car isn't that damaged, yeah. And you can also sometimes fix a car on the spot, but it's, somewhat more slow. And the one real when you lockpick, it brings up this tumbler visual, and basically there are three, I forget what they're called, but you have to set three of them, and if you miss any of them, you lose the ones you had already gotten. So if you're on the third and you screw up, you have to start all over. And basically, you're pushing up I'm just gonna call it the tumbler. You're pushing up one tumbler at a time, and at some point it's going to glow green. And either you keep pushing it up, you have to lock it in place when it's glowing green. And either that means that you keep pressing it up until it reaches green, or maybe you press a little further and then let go of pressing and gravity will bring it through the green. And either way, you have a limited, window into actually locking it. And again, if you press any other time than when it's green, yeah, you lose the ones you already had. And so you have to do this with all three, and then you will have opened the car door and be able to get in. And if you're spotted, yeah, the police are easily going to be able to tell that that's what you're doing. So then it's a matter of, okay, do you cancel it with the strangely far away key, or do you just say, you know what, I'm going to be able to do it, and I need this car. If you don't get the car, then you're just running away from the cops, or you're paying a fine, whatever. Without, so yeah, either you lose money or you lose the car that would have made it a lot easier to get away from the cops. So yeah, that's quite nicely done. But it is the only minigame, and there are also no QTEs. I appreciate that QTEs are quite hated. I find that obviously real gameplay is better than QTE, but so many new games go for neither and go for just, okay, so you're walking between these places and then you press use, which, I mean, there's basically one level in Splinter Cell Blacklist that you can only play when you're playing it through the first time. Even that very first level where you don't get a rating or anything, you can play that again later if you want. But you cannot play this certain one. I'm not going to give away what happens in it. And literally, and this is probably why you can't play it again, you're just walking back and forth and pressing use. Some of the time there's a time limit, but you're just walking back and forth. There's nothing else. I find that, obviously a mini game is better than a QTE, but at least a QTE, just something so that I'm actually doing something, but at the very least there is the lock picking. But yeah, this game badly needed more, because again, then we end up with just you're walking back and forth and pressing use in, missions where that's all that Yeah, for minutes on end. Anyway, there are entire missions that barely get interesting before the end, when you finally get to, like, maybe chase or shoot or something, sneak maybe, but where it's not just you're getting up in the morning, putting on clothes, driving, getting there, walking, using. Yeah. If you get into a car accident, you can get badly hurt, even die, depending on the severity of it. And you can shoot out the tires of a car, shoot the tank to blow it up. Honestly, I didn't find that I was in that many situations where I was dealing with an enemy car that, because again, I can't shoot from the car. So if I'm driving after another car, then obviously I'm not shooting at it at all. And if another car is, then I'm probably chasing after it. I'm not just standing around waiting. But there are some times where, like, enemy backup will arrive in cars, and yeah, then you can shoot at those cars if, but yeah. And honestly, the thing of targeted, kind of, you can also break wood and glass sometimes, and it's so rare. One of the loading screen things actually points out, this is totally a feature we put in the game, just highlighting how rare it is. There are a couple of times, yeah, just a couple throughout the entire game, where you're actually in a place where you can shoot, apart the wood and the glass. Otherwise, it's just, yeah, otherwise it's a completely normal, it gets slightly Red faction-y there, but where Red faction, I've barely played any Red faction, but the little bit I played of the first one, it's, that's awesome. You're taking apart, so much, you can, if an enemy is on a bridge, you can shoot them, or you can shoot out the bridge from under them, and you can actually move around by shoot, making holes that you can then follow. That's awesome. And this just barely has that at all. It's basically that, this, I don't have to wait for them to turn to get out of cover because they're covering behind something I can shoot. Or may and maybe the same for where you're covering. But that's basically it. And just these couple of times, yeah. The environments are okay, they're a little too bland and repetitive. It's like you're not, like, when you look at the area that you're in, it's not necessarily going to be like, oh man, I'm definitely in this area of the city now. I mean, obviously some of the swankier places, yeah, but other than that, it's not that interesting. The overall city is 10 square miles, which I believe is a little, I believe the first one was 12, which, and again, they're not that interesting. So, that would be what you'd hope for when it's smaller, that it's also more interesting. And in this, you cannot come on and take a free ride, the height of the mountain and depth of the valley notwithstanding. At no point in this can you actually just freely go around. Even if you could, there's hardly anything you can do. You can rob places, you can, buy clothes, you can eat and drink. That's basically it. Other than that, it's all missions. And you're always on a mission anyway. So if you're doing stuff like that, you're doing it during a, during at a point in the mission where you're not too worried about things happening, The city is quite empty, and really, this isn't an open world game. It's a third person shooter with a large world. And as far as I understand, it was actually marketed as a sandbox, as an open world game. And yeah, that's just, yeah, several pointed out that this is not the game that 2K promised. And yeah, I'm sorry, that's... I completely understand absolutely hating the game for that. And yeah, I mean, I was aware when I got it that it wasn't going to be, but yeah. You go to almost everywhere, you know, almost every area of the city during the missions, and it will state when you enter a certain neighborhood. And I guess this is so that you do know that there are more, you know, that the neighborhoods are different from one another, because I hardly ever actually noticed a real difference. When you play Grand Theft Auto 3, you work for several different gangs. When you've stopped working for a gang, or when you've fought a gang, you know, some of them you never do work for, but you just fight them while working for a different gang. When you drive through their neighborhood, they will shoot you. And this, you know, this means that you may be like, oh crap, I don't want to deal with them right now. I'll take the long way, you know. There are several different families in this one. I thought that maybe, but not really. And he says, you know, there are times where you're told, you know, okay, now go to that particular neighborhood. It doesn't, you know, it's not like the game expects you to know where it is. You know, you just, it's on the map, you know, so it's not like, yeah. Missions tend to be driving, you know, yeah, you drive from point A to point B, you know, repetitive, linear, very boring. Sometimes you're involved in a chase and, you know, often you are told to kill someone, but yeah, they're way too similar to one another. And there is entirely too much driving in this, like with the first one. I believe in the first, ultimately I found it to be, I want to say 70 or 80%. In this, ultimately it is around 60%, but it's still far too much. And where the first one had these really creative and varied, you know, interesting missions and mission setups, you know, with no real filler, you know, filler time and material within a mission, you know, when you start a mission, you're already where you're getting the briefing. In this, when you're starting a mission, you're just told, okay, go here. Okay, put on clothes, drive there, and yeah. And, you know, a mission would also typically end when you got back to the source, you know, which is obviously, you know, when you're doing a mission, obviously you end up reporting back to the guy, you know, often. And again, in this, you have to go back home. And others have noted that there are some tiresome moralisms in this, and far too many of them. At first, you stay at Joe's apartment. You know, you come back from the war. He's been doing his thing, so he has an apartment. He's doing all right, you know. So you move into that one. Later in the game, you get your own apartment. At that point, both you and Joe live on the third floor of your respective apartments. A mission will start with you going all the way down from the third floor, driving to Joe's, going all the way back up to Joe's floor, going all the way back down, driving, and then the mission can start. And the mission might then end with you driving Joe back, walking him up to the third floor, driving back to your own place, walking up to your third floor, and finally the mission can end. And thankfully, when you're like way ahead of someone walking, you know, out of or into an apartment, you know, when you actually use that final door, you know, taking you outside or taking you into the apartment, the guy will just teleport to there. So you don't have to wait around. So that's something at least. a number of the missions, maybe most of them overall, have a twist. You know, something unexpected will happen or the like. And this will, you know, mean that the mission didn't end quite when you thought it and how you thought it would. But with how boring a lot of them are, it just feels like they're just prolonging the game pointlessly. You can replay any mission from the start using the menu. And, you know, examples of the really cool missions in the first one are going into a hotel to very publicly murder someone and blow up the hotel. A very thief-like, you know, breaking into someone's, I want to say mansion, but it's at least a big house or something, with a safecracker. And, you know, there are a ton of guards. Some of them are patrolling, and, you know, some guards you'll have to sneak right up behind and take out. And, you know, a lot of others you just have to avoid. You know, you go onto a paddle steamer to shoot someone, you know, murder someone in front of everyone. And then, you know, you run back down and take a boat away. And you don't, like, get to drive that boat, but it's still, you know, different, you know. And there's one where a guy you're supposed to kill keeps surviving. You know, he's supposed to be at a certain restaurant, so you call your partner is going to be shooting him, so he, you know, gets into a position where he can shoot whoever, you know, gets on the phone. And then you call from a payphone to, you know, and into the restaurant and ask, could I speak with, you know, dude who I'm gonna have killed? And, you know, he says, one moment, please, walks off, and then you see someone else walking over to the phone, and you're like, okay, yeah, here we go. And, you know, your partner's already, he raises his Tommy gun, dude gets on the phone, I'm sorry, he isn't here today. And, you know, you don't yell to your guy, just, you know, you can't stop your guy in time. So he murders this completely, you know, random, oh, okay, we'll try again later, you know. You know, you put a bomb in a car, it's the wrong person who gets in the car. You know, you're about to mow, you know, your partner's about to mow him down with a Tommy gun, and it jams like they were notorious for. You know, there's a point where you're using a sniper from this, you know, tall tower. It's just such memorable and cool mission ideas, and just, yeah, this has far too little of it. This does have some line of fire kind of stealth, and, you know, it's less than a third of the missions, you know, that actually have this. And it works really well. Like, you know, it'll be super, you know, linear, but you're still, you know, it makes sense. You know, you're, like I say, you're using cover, and really conveniently people will say, I am leaving. You realize that you will be the only one left in this room, and your back will probably be turned to the door through which I am leaving. I just wanted to tell you that in case anyone was listening and needed to sneak in, you know, that kind of thing. But at least it's there. At least it breaks up the tedium of driving and walking and pressing use, and occasionally the reasonably entertaining shootout. Money actually matters in this one. You know, if you're wanted by the police, maybe you have to change clothes, maybe you have to legalize a car, which means, you know, changing the plates, which you can even personalize here. You can also, you know, change out the rims, you know, change the color, and, you know, changing clothes, it may mean going to your apartment and putting on some new that you already have. But if you're far from your apartment and there's a clothing store nearby, yeah, you know, you'll want to go in and just buy some, yeah. And there's also far less of this than in the Grand Theft Auto games where you can buy clothing. So
Yeah.
when you're dealing with the police, you know, maybe they'll try to fine you and you can pay the fine, refuse, you know, you can refuse to surrender, you can bribe, you can, you know, resist arrest. And the thing about money mattering in this one, unlike the first one, is that you don't know when you'll suddenly, excuse me, need a lot of it, or it will, you know, take it away and even Obama your guns away, you know. So if you know, I mean, repair, pay fines, buy, you know, things entirely at your own risk because it might, yeah. You know, yeah, even your clothes, even the, yeah, the one thing you never lose are the cars in the garage. So, yeah. You know, which again means, you know, if you're looking at one of them and you're thinking repairing, you might need a ton for the next mission, or maybe, yeah. And any clothes or guns that you buy, yeah, you might just lose them. So, yeah. And in some of the later parts of this, you're just rich, so you're just throwing away money, and it ends up feeling random rather than earned. You know, obviously it's guided, not random, but the first time you're playing it, you don't know. I appreciate that sometimes, you know, things would go really wrong and suddenly something, but the other Grand Theft Auto games do far better at that. You know, in Grand Theft Auto 3, you work for so many different gangs, so you don't know when, you know, in one mission you're taking orders from someone you're their most trusted, you know, you're working really well for this person. A few missions later, you might be out to kill that person. You know, that's how you do it. That's interesting, but you know, this thing of just, it doesn't feel like you're earning the money for when you're suddenly rich, and then when you might lose them again. Yeah, it just, it almost feels like it, the game is punishing you for not focusing purely on, you know, the cars, the money you'll need for actual missions and stuff like that. You know, I mean, if I ran around and just buying clothes and guns, then the first time I lost all of that, I would have been incredibly frustrated, you know. The graphics are really good. Like in the first one, the lips sync up, but the mouths don't open enough. It looks like bad ventriloquism. But again, they do have very expressive eyes and faces. There are some awkward animation. You know, I should note, the graphics in this are, of course, far better than in the first game. It's just for the time that they came out, they're, you know, and they both do have some of these same things. It's just that obviously it's in more detail in this. But yeah, some really awkward animations sometimes where, you know, taking a prison shower, you know, involves a lot of patting your own chest. And food tends to be, there's just the one texture very obviously, and it's basically like it might even be completely flat. So it, you know, maybe some of the different things in the food might have different, have their own texture each, but it's very clearly just they built this thing and then they textured it and that's it. Joe sports a cross necklace, and you would swear that this is actually a tattoo of a cross necklace. Bushes is where it gets worst. They're this kind of fake 3D. We're talking Duke Nukem 3D level. No matter what side you're looking at them from, you know, there's only the one, you know, no matter the angle, you can only see this one side. And it's just, yeah. And I should note, you know, my computer is, you know, newer than this game, and the I maxed out all of the settings and such. So yeah, this is not like different for different, yeah. There are three stations on the radio, which means that, any given time, there's a good chance that there's going to be some sad music, some happy music, some music that you'll want to hear at that time. You can also just turn it off if you want to. And every so often there will be news announcements, which, like in Grand Theft Auto, will be of your missions often. And, ads. And the music includes rock, doo-wop, R&B, and it's not just a bunch of white guys. There are women, there are black people. It's a ton of licensed music, and it's really great. If you know anything about music from the time period this is set, you're gonna recognize a bunch of it. And yeah, in the first one, maybe it's a budget thing. I don't know exactly, but in the first one, it was much less. The first one has great music, but it's much less like punchy and fun and, yeah. And it might also have to do with like the time it's set. I don't know for sure how much, but yeah, definitely that's a real, if you're getting just one of these two, and you care a lot about the music you're going to be listening to through the game, then yeah, score one for this one. Now, I relatively rarely got into melee combat when someone nearby would shoot, but it is actually. There was one point, I'm not proud of it, but I almost ran over a couple of people. And I didn't really think much of it because you never really know how the AI is going to react. So I got out of the car. One guy took a swing at me, and I'm like, okay, well, I can fight. So I beat him up. Then another guy started to shoot at me, and I forget if I ran away or I shot him or what exactly, but the thing I really want to note is I wasn't shot while trying to melee. I was never in this game shot while trying to melee. And I can't say for sure if it ever happens, but there was one point where I didn't have guns for a very particular reason, which I'm not going to give away, and a bunch of people with guns were like very close by. And I was on one side of a house, and they were approaching from the other two sides. So I was essentially surrounded. But what actually happened was the first person, he came from the one that I was logically facing, and he came by himself. So while he did try to shoot me, it was very easy for me to run up to him and punch him, like, I don't know, a few times. And then he drops his gun. So I pick up his gun, I shoot him, and then the other people start arriving. So I shoot a couple of them, I run away, and all this, that's something vital. You never want for the, you should never be stuck in melee when others are trying to fight you. You should never be in that situation where, unless you yourself really screw up or something, but yeah. And there's an indicator for when cops are maybe looking at you, maybe recognizing you. Enemies, cops will largely ignore crimes committed by the AI. So if you're in, if you're driving and you're like being chased, or maybe chasing someone else who are like, shooting, yeah, firing from the vehicle, anything you do that's illegal, if you're driving beyond the speed limit or something, the cops are going to notice. But you can drive around like that, around cops. If you're not breaking the law, they don't care. They don't notice the other. Yeah. And, you know, sometimes the cops won't notice you if you're stealing a car by tossing the driver out of, you know, opening the door and tossing him out. Maybe break a window to, you know, break into a, you know, a parked car. Maybe you drive away in front of a ton of cops who literally know that there was just a huge crime committed, and they're like trying to figure out who it is. You're speeding past, I mean, not breaking the speed limit, but still right in front of them. And sometimes it's also way too easy to lose the cops. They'll, you know, there'll be one cop car behind you that's going after you, and if you get just a little bit out of sight of that one and you get to another cop car, it's not gonna notice you at all. So yeah, it's very the police AI in this is wildly inconsistent. And the you know sometimes they will you will be seen by enemies in a you know either cops or enemies in a situation where you really shouldn't be. The I do also think that they should maybe have done. The thing is, there's only the you're being seen, you're being recognized indicator for cops, which means that when you're in stealth or, you know, the like, and it's enemies trying, you know, who might be noticing you, it's going to use the same indicator. And it's very clearly a you're being seen by the cops indicator, 'cause it's blue. And when it reaches the full thing, it starts doing the, you know, like police siren thing with the, you know, on the indicator. So yeah, I don't know why they didn't just make two and make the other one red. And like, you know, instead of it going like siren, maybe it's just like an icon of an enemy mobster with a gun out or something. You can rob stores and gas stations. You know, if you rob a gas station, he may call for the cops right after you leave. And if you go into a gun store or a pub, he might, you know, pull a gun on you, so you have to, you know, not get killed in that situation. But this is a way to earn a lot of money if you do suddenly need. And you can also steal cars and have them crushed at this, you know, auto scrapyard kind of thing. The difficulty in this is fairly rarely cheap. I'd say maybe a fifth of the time in the overall game, which really is a pretty good ratio. And in the first one, it's always cheap. You know, it's yeah, it's predominantly cheap. Missions, as you play more and more of this, missions will take you further into the mob world, but they don't all get more difficult as they go, which is both boring and a real disconnect. And like the first one, you'll probably want to play it on the easy difficulty setting. There are three total difficulty settings, and even the easy one will challenge you. The easy one is the only one that has any health regeneration, and I can't see how you could possibly play this game without health regen. And the first one badly needed something like this, you know, so I'm glad that they put it in here, but yeah. And basically, you know, when you're not being shot, literally, when you're not taking bullets or otherwise taking damage, you can heal. You know, the moment that you know, just a few seconds since the last time you were being shot, then you'll start healing, and you'll heal almost the entire way. And you know, you might think that this would lead to them just going for cheap difficulty, but you know, largely not. And this will help you some more for the when you're like trying to figure out where to go and what to do, the first time you interact with, say, a door, if it's a door you can interact with, it'll actually glow golden the first time. You know, if it's like you're breaking in and then later breaking out, you know, and in the same mission breaking out, the second time you get to the door, it's not going to glow. But by then, you know, at that point, it's really up to the player to be. But, you know, the first time you look around, it's like, well, which of these doors can I go through? Where can I vault? Things like that. And yeah, the game tends to indicate that. There is something in this where it relates to the plot of the first one. It is distinctly meh and could easily have been completely eliminated. It's actually, it contains a mild retcon even, and just, yeah, does absolutely nothing. Where the first game took me roughly 20 hours to complete, this one took me basically 11, if I by my own count, if I go by the in-game counter, it's 10. Not only does this, yeah, literally point out that it's half the length of the first game, this is, you might think that with the first one being much more difficult, that it was an indication that the first game is just twice as difficult as this. But no, it really is a lot about the content. There really weren't that many missions in the first one where I spent just, you know, way longer than if I, you know, I mentioned in the video for the first one, I've played so many games that are cheaply difficult and that you have to play a certain way to complete it the first time properly, where it's like, you know, you normally you shouldn't have to like basically be pointing to where you expect the next enemy to spawn in order to, you know, it should be more natural than that. But I realized very early on in the first game that that's how I'm going to have to play it in order to beat it. So I did that for the entire game, basically. And yeah, there were definitely a few where I did have to try more than once, but largely it was, you know, it was that the checkpoint saves meant that I didn't have to replay that much, so I could just, like, you know, very quickly learn from my mistakes and figure out what the next thing to do was. So yeah, it's rather that. Apropos of nothing really, I've just started replaying the Punisher game from, you know, 04 05, right around there. It has almost everything that this does and is better in almost all of it. The main differences between the two is that in that, there is no large world that you're moving in, and you never get to drive a car. And then, you know, you also don't buy clothes and such. Those are already some of the parts of this. Driving a car shouldn't feel like a chore. But in this, so much of the time it does, because you're told to. It's not, oh, I really want to check out this area, or, you know, maybe this area will have a gun or something that I want. No, it's just you're told, now you have to drive from there to there. The end of sentence. That's how it's going to be. You know, both games are, you know, almost entirely linear. Both games, and I'm not saying that that's a good game. It's a licensed game. Licensed games suck. It sucks, but it's fun. You know, games that suck can still be fun to play. And where this is technically more well done in basically every way, a lot of the time this just isn't as fun as that is. And obviously it's today a little harder to come by a to buy that, but I got it back when it was new. This one you certainly can't buy on Steam either for the PC currently. So, but yeah, as a brief, the shooting is far more fun, and there are more or less the same amount of different guns, and it's so much more fun to play to shoot with the different ones in that. In both of them, you're going around killing a bunch of faceless, goons within like organized crime. But in that it's not only, but yeah, they're much more fun to be shooting. The that one doesn't even have a proper cover system at all, and just there are obvious really big, but I'm more than halfway through the game now, and I've realized that basically every time Frank Castle kills a major character, he throws them out of a window from a through out through the window of a building. That's basically his go-to move, and the bosses tend to boil down to, okay, shoot this person a lot, or maybe get a lot of headshots on this person. And it's an arcade style third person shooter, and it has fairly few features, but it's fun, and it doesn't feel it does, at no point in that game do you feel like you're just being made to do this thing that should by own it should be fun to play. At no point, that has far more replayability. The if you only if you play on the highest difficulty setting can you earn all the medals, which means unlocking all the extras. And the extras, not only are the extras, they're fun. It's a game you can, I mean, it's a very short game if you're just completing it once. But once you've completed it once, you'll probably want to try for one of the higher difficulty settings. That way you can also buy some of the extras, the bonuses and the like. And through the game you find a bunch, you unlock concept art and like covers of classic Punisher stories and such. And there's some of that in here, but yeah, it's just that is so much more fun than this. Yet again, saved for last, the from my feminist perspective. I mentioned earlier that there's not a lot of replay value. While you can also find a number of these in the if you complete missions on the hardest difficulty setting, then you will unlock pinups from the time. Feminist frequency in her Women as Reward Tropes versus Video Game in video does explains this far better than I could. So I will just direct you to that one. No, I don't agree with everything feminist frequency says. And certainly I don't, yeah, I wish that that a lot, maybe even most of the replies to her weren't just sexist garbage. And for great addressing of her actual points, watch Tool Time's videos on her. This has nudity, sexuality, completely casual. Like, it's mostly, they're prostitutes, but, they're of course seductive all the time, because it's not like they're actual people. They're objects for your pleasure, and the women in your family are objects for you to keep safe. You know, at no point in this is a woman anything other than an object, and they're abused by some of the men, and that's just supposed to be atmosphere, which, I'm not saying that it always has to matter, that it always has to have an impact, that you can't have things for atmosphere, but you really don't need to have entire characters for that. You can, and certainly not have them this disposable. But yeah, and the game is of course only showing female nudity. The aforementioned prison shower, everyone is in tidy whities because no homo. And before you say it wouldn't be allowed, Penumbra: Black Plague, Cane Lynch: Dog Days, and especially Outlast has plenty of male nudity, which isn't shied away from at all. In Black Plague, there aren't a ton of enemies, but I'm pretty sure every single enemy is, fully nude, and mostly, they're not completely human still necessarily, but they're clearly they're humanoid, and yeah. And in Outlast, yeah, plenty of the patients of the asylum are naked. And I mentioned earlier, accents and dialects, language tends to be pretty realistic, but even though the races didn't mix when this was said, it really doesn't excuse that they're also stereotypical, and incredibly racist statements are made completely casually, and it isn't excused by, oh, well, it's just the protagonist's point of view. It goes way too far, and I'm not the first to point out at one point you're sent to kill an Asian person, and literally killing them, the achievement for killing them is a reference to this, old racist yeah. I've reviewed other parts of this franchise, the links are in the description box. Please comment, thumbs up, and subscribe for more content.